correspondent Christine Romans joins us now with more. It may have had the opposite effect.
I don't think it reassured anybody. People last night trying to figure out what in the world he was talking about. So he spent Sunday calling bank CEOs from his vacation in Mexico in a bid to reassure investors after the worst week since the financial crisis. First, the damage report here. This is what he never suggested the president can fire Powell. The president said that. And Chief of Staff Mick Mulvaney said the president realizes he can't fire Powell. But even talking about firing Powell is just so bad for the markets. The president has often attacked him for raising interest rates, blames him for the market plunge. Interest rates have gone up 7 times since Trump took office for just this year.
So, Christy, what was the Treasury Secretary thinking? Because he presumably should know better.
I don't know. It sounds like it was a check-in call with these banks just to say, you know, it was a really terrible week on Wall Street. The banks are like, yeah, everything's fine. You know, we've got everything's fine. It was just a bad week on Wall Street. But at the forefront, when you see these comparisons to the financial crisis, that must be a real burr under the saddle of the administration. Every time you say since the financial crisis, since the Depression, they don't like that.
And really quickly, how often do those calls normally happen?
They happen from time to time. I mean, the Treasury Secretary is in contact with the bank chiefs. But this made it sound like it was some extraordinary
circumstance. I'm calling to make sure.
And specifically about the ample liquidity. I'm telling you, the smartest minds in money all day yesterday were like, why did he say that? No one thought there was a problem with liquidity. Why inject it into the debate? As one Democratic senator said, it's like being in the health department saying, don't worry, your water's not poisoned. I heard someone say it's like saying to your spouse, don't worry, honey, I'm not cheating on you. You know what? Why would you even bring that up?
These are not best practices.
No. 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 Did not inspire confidence.
All right.
Thank you.
Up next.
Correspondent Christine Romans joining us now with more. There's also these questions of these phone calls that Steve Mnuchin made from Mexico over the weekend to the heads of top banks to sort of try to reassure them. Could these two be connected?
Oh, I think so. I mean, I think the Treasury Secretary is under intense pressure from the president because the president has tied his own fortunes to the fortunes of the stock market. How many times have we heard him talk about the Dow's up 25%, it's the best stock market in the history of mankind, you know? And now you have a Dow last week that was the worst week since the financial crisis, December on track for the worst month since the Great Depression, and these are comparisons that must gall this president, and he wants the Fed chief to, or the Treasury Secretary to do something. At the same time, he's bashing his Fed chief. He blames the Treasury Secretary for the Fed chief pick because he was, look, no matter who is the Fed chief, you're going to see interest rates rising. There's no question about that. This president is just very angry about it.
But I mean, look, it doesn't take an economist to understand that if the president of the United States attacking him, that will be a prime driver of the stock market down. That's got to rattle the confidence
of
markets.
It does not inspire confidence. What also does not inspire confidence is when the Treasury Secretary, under pressure from the president, our White House team is reporting, sends out this press release after these phone calls. He's on vacation in Cabo San Lucas. He sends out this press release about the calls with the big bank CEOs. How populist is this, right?
It's very populist to go Christmas in Cabo.
Ship to shore, to the most powerful bankers in the world. And he says there is ample liquidity in the system. The CEOs of these banks have assured us there's ample liquidity in the system. And the money reporters and the money folks and the financial experts are like, well, the Treasury Secretary just issued a statement saying there's ample liquidity. Of course there's ample liquidity in the system. Nobody thought there wasn't. So it's injecting this doubt into the whole thing that there's a Democratic senator who said it's like being the head of the health department and issuing a press release saying the water is safe to drink. Well, wait a minute, the water couldn't be safe to drink? It's like a spouse saying to the other spouse, don't worry, honey, I'm not cheating on you. Wait, there could be a possibility you're cheating on me? I mean, that's what the kind of doubt that it injected into the conversation. And it just was a very clumsy message, if indeed this is the Treasury Secretary under pressure from the president to fix the declines in the stock market.
The clumsiest message. You couldn't design something more to undermine confidence than say, everyone's got enough liquidity, folks. Nothing to worry about here. Remain calm.
And shouldn't a Treasury Secretary know that putting out a statement like that and injecting that into the discussion?
Or what is the infrastructure around it? So I called the Treasury Press Affairs number about a half an hour ago. So I was like, look, I'm just gonna beg somebody over there to come on the record and tell me, are you guys gonna, you know, try to clean up this message? It goes to an operator number because the press office, they're all, you know, they're on furlough. So that sort of shows you the merger of, you know, a market that's, look, this could be a garden variety correction in the market. These things happen. It could be that there's high frequency trading and algorithm trading that kind of is exacerbating the volatility. That's one thing. But it sounds as though they're trying to message away from, you know, the president's attacks on the Fed chief, the president's shutdown or Pelosi's shutdown or whoever you want to blame for it. The fact that the economy, you know, a year after tax cuts,
Yeah.
You know, maybe they weren't as much juice as they thought.
Is there any precedent for a president going after his Fed chair to this extent?
I think so. I know, well, publicly, I don't think so.
Publicly.
But look, every president has not liked rising interest rates. There's no question about that. And they've grumbled about it. But this is, you know, I've never reported on a president privately asking his aides, can I fire my Fed chief? And having to be told, no, you can't fire your Fed chief. And even if you had the authority to fire the Fed chief, the message that would send around the world would be very devastating.
Tough stuff.
It's just, it's so much for a government shutdown, right? It's just there's so much happening. Open up a door and there's something else there.
There's something else there. It's like an advent calendar.
It's an advent
and
calendar
look,
of disaster.
It's Christmas Eve.
Yes.
But will it be over tomorrow?
No. There are going to be a lot of presents under that tree tomorrow. Not the kind you want. Christine, thank you. We do also have some more breaking.
Business correspondent Christine Romans is here. Where are you on regifting?
I think regifting is fine. Just make sure you regift it to somebody who the first person doesn't find out.
Take the card out also.
Right,
my advice.
Right.
I know from experience you need to take the card out.
You know, they say, it's the thought that counts, of course. But look, I don't want that reindeer sweater with jingle bells, right? So some retailers have a no-questions-asked policy to return. Others have strict rules that make returning purchases frustrating or impossible. Here's what you can do to make returns easier, okay? Don't open the box. Little lads and lasses, where are they? Still the top choice.
Very quickly, explain to Allison why you don't ever want me to buy you presents.
Okay, well, here's the thing. I did bring Allison a gift, but I didn't bring you one this year.
What?
Well, John and I have an arrangement.
I know you do. I'm curious about it.
So I was overwhelmed in the holidays. I said, look, you're a good enough friend that, please, brought me a gift anyway to make me feel twice as guilty.
Exactly.
You bad man.
My gift to you is
guilty. Exactly.
You bad man.
My gift to you is a re-gift, and it's something that you can consume and enjoy and doesn't clutter up your house.
I don't care how you paid for it. Thank you. I love
this. Merry Christmas, John.
We just bought only you a present.
Well, we have this arrangement, right, John?
Christine Romans. Yeah. Right? Merry Christmas. Appreciate it.